This is the world's largest mangrove habitat of Royal Bengal tigers, the Sundarbans, at the mouth of the Bay of Bengal in South Asia. It is also the source of livelihood for countless humans dwelling on its fringes for generations. They are forest fishers or wild honey gatherers, rowing in these tangled jungles to catch fish and crabs or look for beehives deep within tiger dens. And who knows, not all who enter the forest may be destined to return. As Sundarban tigers are known to hunt humans for food. Such villages surrounding the forest are replete with these incidents of tiger attacks and human deaths. According to these villagers, more than 100 persons have died and many more injured by tigers during the last 5 years. However, there was new hope in these villages. A small group of forest fishers, tiger widows and victims from villages of Lahiripur in Goshaba Island decided to form the Sundarban Rural Development Society, or SRDS, in 2011. Its aim was to prevent further loss of human life and enable local villagers to continue with their traditional means of livelihood while staying away from the deadly tigers. More villagers joined hands, and together they made it possible by growing their own community mangrove forests in such vacant land outside their villages. Today, they are converting more and more areas of these river banks into tracts of mangrove wilderness. And thus, marches ahead this community mangrove brigade from one village to another. The mangrove kingdom of the Sundarbans sprawls over 10,000 square kilometers along the Ganges Delta, across the countries of India and Bangladesh. Our story takes you through the lives of indigenous forest communities living in villages along the Indian Sundarban at the southern tip of West Bengal. The supreme deity of these tidal jungles is the legendary Ma Bonbibi, believed to be an Arabian goddess. The local communities offer prayers to her before entering the forest for her divine protection from the tigers. But even then, sometimes the worst does happen. Gautam Ridha from the village of Pathurpara had gone fishing with his fellow villagers, never to return again. Such fishing trips deep within the jungles often last for a week. When the villagers have to spend their nights in the boats, and that is when they are most vulnerable to these deadly attacks. Gautam Ridha's body could not be recovered from the jungle. And what followed is a rare kind of death ritual observed by the bereaved family. A doe kneaded with white flour is roughly shaped as a human figure. This image is henceforth treated as the body of the deceased. This anointed figure is then cremated in a specially erected funeral pyre in the village.
It is impossible to bring back home the bodies of those killed in tiger attacks. Hence, this is the way we perform the last rites and pray for the peace of the departed soul. Gautam Ridha is the third member of our family to be claimed by the tiger. Earlier, it was my mother and elder brother.
Gautam is survived by his widow, Gita Ridha. Alapi Mondol, tiger widow from Kagmari village, lost her husband nearly 15 years ago. She recalls with horror the last she saw of him being dragged by the tiger from the boat in the jungle. Few months ago, widower Norin Mondol also lost his wife in a tiger attack. Such memories of the dead live on in such elegies sung in these forest villages. Gange joare lo phire tumi ele koi khidki duare khule patha pane chero.
টাঙে জোয়ারে লো ফিরে তুমি এলে কই।
Though it is very rare to survive a tiger attack, some do come back, but with telltale marks of injuries and pain that last for life. Like Oshith, Dinesh Mundul from Rajut Jubilee village also had a miraculous escape from the jaws of death. But his survival was not easy. He had to undergo more than 100 stitches all over his gnawed body. His belongings had to be sold off to pay for his long treatment. No compensation was provided by the Forest Department despite repeated pleas for help with required documents. But due to more availability of fish in these parts of the forest, local communities are often compelled to sneak into them without permission from the Forest Department. Hence, incidents of deaths or injuries during such trips do not enter official records. However, even as fishing zones for local communities are getting squeezed within their native jungle, new areas are being opened up for growing number of tiger sighting tourists.
Tourism jara ache bhin desh theke tara bhotbhoti niye
tourists arrive in Sundarban from different parts of the world. They move in core areas of the reserve using loud motor boats that create pollution. The solitude in the jungles is disturbed and we feel wildlife comes under stress. Smoke of diesel used in motor boats deposit carbon on mangrove plants, ultimately destroying them.
Such circumstances are increasingly pushing out the local communities from their age-old mangrove forests, resulting in a loss of their traditional livelihood. This is in violation of India's commitments under the UN Convention on Biological Diversity, CBD, on conservation that respects traditional practices of local communities. But these villagers have not given up. They are voicing their fishing rights in the tiger habitat.
Forest Rights Act 2006 guarantees us community rights to practice our traditional livelihood in Sundarbans. But despite the law, we are denied of our legitimate demands. We are assaulted by the forest persons and driven out of our native jungles.
Boat rallies are also organized in these villages to draw the attention of the Forest Department. The Act, however, does not exempt West Bengal from its implementation. Provisions of Convention on Biological Diversity also oblige India to protect communities' customary sustainable use of biodiversity and their authority to guide the forest management for these purposes. Further, the government is committed to obtain their consent and involvement in its decisions and measures of forest protection and tourism in tiger reserves. However, none of these CBD commitments are being followed, as India carries on with its contrary sanctuary policies, where villagers get continuously killed and deprived of their livelihood. At this juncture, local village body, the Sundarban Rural Development Society, approached its fellow villagers with a solution. If the forest department is restricting their entry in the tiger habitat, why not grow their own mangrove forests and restore natural water bodies to revive their traditional livelihood? This would reduce human pressures in the jungle and protect more lives from tiger attacks. CBD also calls for community-based initiatives for restoration of threatened ecosystems as mangroves for life and livelihood of local communities.
Root, jegulo shikor, egulo elakar bibhinno mas fish ba crab kakra.
Roots of mangroves nourish fish and crabs when they come afloat in the forest through tidal waters. These tangled roots also act as nurseries for juveniles of fish and crabs. Flowers of many species of mangroves are sources of rich honey. We need our native mangroves for survival of our traditional livelihood.
With this basic objective, Core Committee of SRDS began with door-to-door survey of its surrounding villages near the forest. It was found that Pathurpara, Anpur, Tiplighiri Adibashi Para, Chargheri, and Porushmoni had the highest number of victims and families affected by tiger attacks. These became the first lot of villages to be selected by the community members for restoration of mangrove ecology. Villagers started off this mangrove movement by identifying vacant areas for plantation near river banks outside their villages. Washed by the tides from Bay of Bengal twice a day, these intertidal areas are ideal for the growth of the Sundarban mangroves, adapted to conditions of high salinity. Their seeds dispersed by tidal waters near riverbeds are largely collected by the women, including tiger widows, from the target villages. They are henceforth planted in plastic bags filled with soil. Mangrove